Thank you very much, dear President, dear Vito, dear members of the Tribunal de Contas, dear professors, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure for me to be here today, and it is an honor to follow the invitation by Vito Caldera, in whose footsteps I'm treading at the European Court of Auditors. I was asked to speak about the European Court of Auditors and public procurement, indeed a very complex and economically important field. EU public procurement policy is a key instrument in establishing the single market and in achieving smart, sustainable, and inclusive growth. At the same time, it shall ensure the most efficient use of public funds. Among other things, EU public procurement rules aim to ensure that the principles and fundamental freedoms in the European treaties are observed. This would in turn increase competition and cross-border trading, resulting in better value for money for public authorities and, of course, for the public as such. At the same time, it increases productivity in the supply industries and improves participation in and access to such markets for small and medium enterprises. In short, the public procurement rules exist to support the single market, encourage competition, and promote better value for money. Just some figures to show you the significance of public procurement in the European Union. The estimate of total general government expenditures on works, goods, and services was over 2,015 billion euros in 2015. This represents 13.1% of the EU gross domestic product. Tenders within the scope of the EU directives amounted to over 349 billion euros in the same year. The proportion of the value of tenders to the GDP is used as an indicator of how widely public procurement is used. Tenders within the scope of the EU directives need to be published online in the Tenders Electronic Daily Database, TED. In 2012, the total value of tenders published in TED was 3.1% of the EU's gross domestic product. In some member states, tendering above the threshold is less than this average. For example, in Germany, 1.1%, Austria, 1.5%, Ireland, 1.5%, and Luxembourg, 1.6%. It shows that across the EU, the performance of member states' public procurement sectors varies quite substantially. Let me very briefly summarize the legal basis for public procurements in the European Union. The EU public procurement framework is based on the agreement on government procurement, GPA, a multilateral agreement between a number of World Trade Organization members that regulates the procurement of goods and services by public authorities. Within the European Union, public procurement is governed by the EU public procurement directives. These directives establish common rules and procedures which public authorities have to follow. The rules are intended to ensure that companies from across the single market have the opportunity to compete for public contracts. These EU-wide rules apply regardless of whether the funds are purely national or whether EU funds are involved. The EU public procurement legislation is based on three main pillars coming from the treaty principles. First, transparency, second, equal treatment, and third, non-discrimination. The EU public procurement directives establish minimum standards and help create a level playing field. Member states have the possibility to accommodate national particularities and needs and may choose to pass laws that are more specific or stricter in some respects. It is important to note, however, that by far not all procurements fall under the scope of the EU directives. The EU directives stipulate minimum value thresholds below which contracts are subject only to national public procurement rules, the third layer of public procurement governance. You can infer from the figures I mentioned before that only about 17% of the public procurement tenders fall within the scope of the EU directives. Any attempt to elevate the thresholds would therefore exclude even more public procurement tenders from the scope of the EU directives. The annual estimated savings through having EU legislation on public procurement is between 6.4 billion and 35.5 billion euro, based on 2014 data, but you see it's a wide range of possible estimations. The estimate of additional annual savings that could be made by completing the single market in public procurement is between 36.5 billion to 66.5 billion euro. Where do we, the auditors, come in with regard to public procurement? Failure to comply with public procurement rules is not only about compliance. It can seriously affect value for money. Therefore, proper implementation of procurement rules is paramount for effective public spending. In this sense, the role of audit of public procurement is twofold. First, corrective. Where the audit findings relate to errors committed in the procurement procedures in the past, obviously the ex post nature of the audit means that the procurement cannot be rectified and the impact in most serious cases may go in the direction of correcting the budget spending, so-called financial corrections. Second, preventive. On the other hand, audit helps to identify areas of public procurement prone to errors so that these can be addressed by the relevant authorities, either on European Union or on national level. Thus, it comes as no surprise that public procurement is an important part of the work of the court. First of all, as part of its annual statement of assurance work. Over the 2009 to 2015 period, the court examined nearly 2,000 transactions co-financed from the EU budget through the European Regional Development Fund, the Cohesion Fund, and the European Social Fund. This included verifying public procurement procedures relating to more than 1,000 projects. Errors relating to public procurement were detected in around 35%, that means more than a third of all of these projects. In total, more than 650 errors were detected. For the purpose of our annual reports, two types of errors are distinguished. First, quantifiable errors. These are serious failures to comply with the procurement rules, such as a serious breach of the rules with the result that competition was impeded and contracts were deemed to have been awarded to those who were not the best bidders. Second, non-quantifiable errors, such as incorrect application of the selection criteria, shortcomings in the tender specifications, and non-compliance with information and publication requirements. The quantifiable and thus serious errors made up almost one-third of all procurement errors detected and accounted for 35% of the court's estimated error rate for funding from the European Regional Development Fund, the Cohesion Fund, and the European Social Fund over the 2009 to 2015 period, a real serious matter. Errors were detected throughout the procurement phases, with the biggest share of quantifiable errors detected in the pre-tendering phase. And most errors detected in this phase were quantifiable. Contracting authorities avoided procurement procedures altogether by awarding contracts directly where a procurement procedure should have been carried out, or split contracts into smaller tenders to avoid exceeding thresholds or used an inappropriate procedure. Many contracts that were directly awarded in this way involved the provision of services rather than works. In the tendering phase, most quantifiable errors were detected in the specification application of selection or award criteria. Errors relating to publication and transparency requirements accounted for the highest number of errors. In the contract management phase, quantifiable errors concern modifications or extensions to the scope of contracts without using a procurement procedure where such a procedure was required. The court's experience when auditing public procurement errors suggests that problems of non-compliance are related to weak implementation of existing rules. Clerical mistakes also lead to errors. Insufficient planning of projects and tendering procedures is also a cause of error, particularly those occurring in the contract management phase regarding modification of or extension of contracts. Fraud, of course, can also be a cause of error in public procurement. According to the OECD, public procurement is the government activity most vulnerable to waste, fraud, and corruption due to its complexity, the size of the financial flows it generates, and the close interaction between the public and the private sectors. There's a legal obligation for member states to report to the Commission all irregularities exceeding 10,000 euro, indicating those where they suspect fraud to have been involved. The European Anti-Fraud Office, OLAF, collects this information. The information reported by member states comprises all types of irregularities, including those related to public procurement. Concerning cohesion policy, in the period 2007 to 2013, 38% of the approximately 12,000 irregularities reported by the member states related to public procurement. Of the irregularities relating to public procurement, 2% were reported to be linked to fraud. The court refers any project which it suspects had been affected by fraud to OLAF. The court referred to OLAF 17 such projects, six of which related to public procurement, as a result of its work on its statement of assurance on the area of cohesion policy in respect of the period from 2009 to 2013. The court analyzed the issue of public procurement in great detail in its special report number 10 of 2015, where we assessed whether the Commission and the Member States have been taking effective action to address problems with public procurement in EU cohesion expenditure. The responsibility for EU spending under cohesion policy is shared between the Commission and the Member States. A significant part of this money is spent through public procurement. We found that failure to comply with public procurement rules has been a perennial and significant source of error in the European Union cohesion expenditure. Serious errors resulted in a lack or complete absence of fair competition. The Commission and the Member States have started to address the problem, but there is still a long way to go and efforts need to be intensified. The Court observed the systematic analysis is very limited and there is a lack both at the Commission and the Member States of sufficiently detailed, robust, and coherent data on the nature and extent of the errors. We recommended that the Commission and the Member States fully analyze the frequency, seriousness, and causes of public procurement errors in the area of cohesion policy. And we called for a high-level group to be set up to provide leadership in tackling the public procurement errors and to promote simplification. I think simplification is a key word here. The legal framework for public procurement in many member states is perceived as more complex than it needs to be. And as a basic rule, the more complex the legal framework is, the more it is prone to error. And I personally feel a little bit guilty of this, because when I was coordinator of my political group in the Legal Affairs Committee, in the beginning of the century, we had been in charge of one of the renewals of the public procurement directives. And if I take a look back now from another position, my feeling is that in many areas we have not simplified, we have more complicated things. And when then member states' legislation adds additional complications on it, then we end up in a situation like in the country that I know best, where normally a small entity like a village or a small city is not able to do a European wide competition during a procurement procedure, it needs a law office to do that, because it's so complicated, they are simply unable to execute these procurement procedures without the support of specialized public lawyers on this issue. And that shows that there is something wrong and that all legislation should be bound to simplify and to make things easier so that could be handled and that the number of errors will be reduced. The Commission has already begun to put a range of actions in place since 2010. Legislative actions included the revision of the public procurement directives. The practical impact of the new public procurement legislation is still to be seen. But it seems that the complexity of the legal framework for public procurement on EU and national level has not become less now. The call for simplification is therefore more pertinent than ever. Also, member states started only quite recently to take comprehensive actions to prevent errors from occurring. I believe that a lot still needs to be done, both on union as well as on national level. Ladies and gentlemen, the court's experience shows that the causes of errors tend to be similar across the member states. Therefore, the court is of the opinion that the exchange of information and experience between the Supreme Audit Institutions and the ECHA, the European Court of Auditors, may help in tailoring the measures to counteract errors in public procurement in a more precise way. Thank you very much for your attention.